Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff. On the NewsHour tonight, the range of response. Efforts to combat the coronavirus vary widely across the United States. I talk with a leading Republican senator and a Democratic governor on the different approaches to reopening. Then, the effect on children. Nationwide stay-at-home orders raise concerns over child welfare and a potentially dramatic increase in child abuse. And hostage of the Taliban, the family of a contractor kidnapped in Afghanistan, speaks for the first time as peace talks deteriorate. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
Consumer Cellular. Financial services firm, Raymond James.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SchoolFoundation.org.
The Lemelson Foundation, committed to improving lives through invention in the U.S. and developing countries. On the web at lemelson.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Tensions over when and how fast to reopen dominate American life tonight. States and cities are setting their own pace as they weigh two overriding factors: economic devastation and nearly 84,000 deaths in the United States and counting. Stephanie Tsai has our lead report.
Grabbing a drink at the bar may never have felt so risky.
We have the staff doing their thing with the cleaning. We're taking temperatures of the staff coming in. So yeah, we've taken a lot of other steps that were predictable and we got it done.
In places like Palm Beach, Florida, more restaurants are reopening. Other cities say they're not ready, including Washington, D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser.
We're not there yet and not quite ready to begin that phase new opening. So today, we will extend the district stay-at-home order through Monday, June the 8th.
Decisions on when to lift lockdowns and let businesses reopen are playing out nationwide after the White House and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention disagreed on when and how that should happen. An unreleased CDC document obtained by the Associated Press shows the agency called for a national guide to reopening, outlining steps that all Americans need to take in every community. But the White House shelved the guidance, instead leaving the process up to state and local officials. Senator Chuck Schumer called for the release of those guidelines on the Senate floor today.
The point is that America needs and must have the candid guidance of our best scientists, unfiltered, unedited, uncensored by President Trump or his political minions.
President Trump spoke this afternoon with the governors of Colorado and North Dakota. It came a day after Dr. Anthony Fauci and the nation's other top health experts warned against reopening too quickly, and as Fauci drew fire from conservative circles.
Look, he wants to play all sides of the equation. It's I was surprised by his answer, actually, because, you know, it's just, to me, it's not an acceptable answer. especially when it comes to schools.
Meanwhile, the chair of the Federal Reserve, Jerome Powell, urged Washington to take more action to prevent a lasting recession today.
Additional fiscal support could be costly, but worth it if it helps avoid long-term damage and leaves us with a stronger recovery. It'll take some time to get back to where we were. I have every reason to think we can get back there. The economy should substantially recover once the virus is under control.
Many health experts have warned the virus won't come under control until testing is more widely available. A new House Oversight Subcommittee held its first hearing today on testing and tracing the virus.
Testing is critical. Testing tells us who has the disease and who doesn't. And testing is the cornerstone of controlling every single disease outbreak. It was inadequate testing that precipitated the national shutdown.
The U.S. has conducted more than 9 million COVID tests, more than any other country, but trails other nations in per capita testing. Germany now tests at a similar rate to the U.S., but made testing available much earlier in the country's outbreak, avoiding a higher death rate there. That relative success is partly why masked passengers are checking into flights in Frankfurt once again. The German government began a gradual easing of border controls this week, aiming to open travel across the EU by mid-June. And in Turkey, playgrounds filled with masked patrons today. After a drop in COVID cases there, the government allowed children under 14 to leave their house for 4 hours. Istanbul local Mehmet Karaman is grateful to be outside, albeit briefly.
I haven't been out in 2 months. They gave us permission today, but I don't know for how many hours. No need to calculate that now. We're really happy and God willing, the coronavirus will end.
Masks over smiling faces. Short moments of relief in the long-haul push to end a pandemic. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.
Worries about the risks of reopening and about a slow recovery took a toll on Wall Street. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 516 points, 2%, to close below 23,248. The Nasdaq fell 139 points, and the S&P 500 gave up 50. Senator Lamar Alexander is the chairman of the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee. His hearing on Capitol Hill yesterday focused on the Trump administration's handling of the coronavirus pandemic. He joins us now from Tennessee, where he is currently in self-quarantine. Senator Alexander, thank you very much for talking with us. First of all, how are you doing, and how is your staff member doing who had tested positive?
He's fine. I just talked with him a few minutes ago. He lost his sense of smell, but that's it. You know, that's the symptom that alerted him. And I'm fine, too. I was just exposed for a short period of time. And so under the protocol, the Senate physician says 2 weeks.
Well, we're glad to hear that both of you are doing well so far. Let me ask you about yesterday's hearing. As you know, the senior health officials in the Trump administration, Dr. Anthony Fauci and others, testified essentially that every state needs to be careful as it opens up, because if it moves too quickly and doesn't have the adequate amount of testing in place, there could be more illnesses, more death, loss of livelihood. But, Senator, this comes the day after President Trump said, we have met the moment and we've prevailed with regard to testing. So who's right here?
Well, I think we have a ways to go, and I think we'll do it state by state like we do most things in our country. For example, our governor, Bill Lee, is testing aggressively every prisoner, every nursing home resident, drive-through testing on the weekends. Anyone can get a test at the local public health department. I talked to a reporter this morning in McMinnville who said he'd showed up twice and gotten his free test, and the governor's motto, if in doubt, get a test. So as a result, in our state, we will have by the end of the month tested about 7% of our population, which will help us monitor what's happening as we go back to work and eventually back to school.
Let me ask you something else about comparing the United States to other countries like Germany, like South Korea, where testing started much earlier. In South Korea, they've been able to hold the total death number to something like 300 compared to 81,000 in the United States.
What are lessons learned that the U.S. should learn from these other countries?
Well, the South Korea example is certainly one that we should pay attention to because of their lower death number. The United States had a glitch at the beginning with a botched test from CDC. Any president would have been very unhappy with that. But since then, what the United States has done has been very impressive. Nearly 10 million tests conducted today, twice as many as any country, more per capita than South Korea, for example, which is very good news for principals and chancellors who are thinking about all the students who will want to go back to school in August, because it creates the possibility that you could test whole classes or whole schools as part of a way of keeping them safe.
One other thing in connection with this, Senator, the president has been pressing some states that have not been prepared to open early, like Pennsylvania, and said that they're making a mistake. He said yesterday there just seems to be no effort in getting certain blue states to get back in gear. Should he be pressing these states this way?
Well, he can do whatever he wants to do. He's the president. He also toured the state of Georgia. They were going too fast, and that's a red state. So I think most governors don't want to be told by the president what to do. They want to be able to have the tests their way, the schedules their way, the colleges their way. And I think the president understands that. He's got a right to express his own opinion.
Senator, we know that the House of Representatives is looking at legislation this week to provide aid to state and local governments. Figure $3 trillion has been thrown out. $1 trillion of that supposedly would be for state and local governments. Have you decided where you stand on that?
Well, I haven't seen it. I've decided this, that we ought to send the money that we've already appropriated out, that's $3 trillion, and see how it works. Much of it has not yet gone out. For example, all the money for hospitals hasn't gone out. And the first thing we should do with states is give them more flexibility on the money we've already given them. But no amount of money will solve the hurt that this is causing people. The only thing that will work are testing, tracking those who are exposed, isolating the sick, and then moving ahead on a very rapid pace with treatments and vaccines, which is happening right now.
Senator Lamar Alexander, who is chairman of the Senate Health Committee. Senator, thank you very much.
Thank you, Judy.
Few states have been hit harder by the coronavirus than New Jersey, which is second only to New York for the total number of deaths caused by COVID-19. And while most other states in the country are reopening, the Garden State has been under near lockdown for months. Earlier today, its governor, Democrat Phil Murphy, announced plans to allow some non-essential businesses to reopen. And he joins us now from Trenton. Governor Murphy, thank you very much for talking with us. It is the case that New Jersey has had some of the worst numbers in the country, but you've also seen improvement by all measurements in the last few weeks in terms of cases, in terms of hospitalizations, and even deaths. You did make this announcement today to begin to open up some businesses. How do you make a decision like that?
Good to be with you, Judy. You're absolutely right. We've made progress, and yet we are, particularly in terms of cases per 100,000 residents, fatalities per 100,000 residents, hospitalizations, we're number one in the nation. So even more impacted than New York and on a per capita basis. We have to balance it. We opened up state and county parks 2 weekends ago, imploring folks to keep up social distancing, wear face covers, limiting capacity on parking spaces that work quite well. So our progress has allowed us to take some more what I would call baby steps. There will be no day, at least that I can see, that will flip a big light switch and a whole lot of things are going to happen all at once. We're going to take, I think, a series of iterative steps, and that, which also, by the way, gives us a chance to evaluate them in real time to see how the things we announced, non-essential retail curbside pickup today, we expanded construction, we allowed drive-through, free steps that we can monitor over the coming days.
We were looking at some other statistics. When it comes to new positive cases per 100,000 people, New Jersey is still struggling, if you will, when you compare to other states. Is this one of the reasons that you are holding back? Because we know you, like other governors, are getting pressure from business owners, from others, to open up.
It is one of the reasons. You're absolutely right. So if you look at per capita numbers of all the American states per 100,000 residents, unfortunately, we're in the pole position on positive tests, hospitalizations, and fatalities. Now, having said that, your opening remarks are also true. We've made enormous progress over the past couple or 3 weeks on hospitalizations, flattening the test curve, ICU beds, ventilator use, the heat maps that we look at. So essentially, we're in one of these moments that we're trying to balance the progress with still in a grave, serious situation and recognizing that while we've made a lot of progress, we're not out of the woods yet.
Governor, I want to specifically ask you about nursing homes, because as I was looking today, you've had something like 5,000 deaths among nursing home long-term care facility residents. More than half of your state's fatalities have been nursing home residents, well over the national rate. The worst outbreak has been at a home for military veterans in Paramus. Over 90% of the residents there have tested positive, 72 deaths. What do you say to the families of these people?
It's awful. I mean, the tragedy within the tragedy is long-term care facilities. You know, we're the densest state in America, and our density is a huge asset most days. In something like this, it's a huge cross that we bear, frankly. It's a tragedy. There's just no other way to put it. And it isn't just veterans' homes, although it is certainly our blessed veterans we've lost. But we've got this running through our state, as by the way, most every other state has as well, but we're no exception to that. The performance by the operators has been extremely uneven. This is a virus, clearly, that eats away at older folks, particularly folks with underlying health conditions. We have thrown everything at this, more staffing, National Guard, the VA. Our attorney general's launched an investigation. We've hired a nationally recognized firm to come in and plus up our staffing and oversight. It is the tragedy within the tragedy. New Jersey is no exception, but it is certainly the case here. And you're absolutely right. It's over half of the fatalities in our state to date.
Will there be policy changes as a result of this?
Absolutely. Absolutely. This is an industry. Again, this is not unique to New Jersey. This is an industry which is very unevenly regulated, and the performance is uneven. And that's being charitable, including the very basic stuff of communicating with loved ones on the status of a resident, for instance. But the answer is absolutely yes. Yes, there will be changes to this industry in our state, and I would guess our country.
Governor, part of the work that you're saying you're going to be starting to do now involves, as we've been discussing nationally, contact tracing, of course, more testing. You were talking about that. Does New Jersey have the financial wherewithal to cover what it is going to cost to do the necessary testing and contact tracing?
Yeah, we will do what it takes in terms of testing and contact tracing, and we've promised to at least double our testing, by example, by the end of this month. New Jersey does not have all the resources it needs, and New Jersey's not unique, and it's not unique just to blue states either. This is a time for direct federal cash assistance to states. I applaud Senator Menendez in our state, who's got a bipartisan bill with Senator Cassidy of Louisiana. I applaud Speaker Pelosi, with whom I'm speaking regularly, including this morning, on the bill that she came out with yesterday. That's exactly what the doctor ordered. And again, not just for my state, but for all states in the middle of this. You know, this is the most critical healthcare crisis, the biggest crisis any of us have ever faced. And at this moment in time, we need the federal government there in a big way in terms of its financial support.
But I'm sure you know Republicans from the leadership on down are saying they don't see a rush to do this, that a lot of these states asking for money have mismanaged their finances and shouldn't be given more money until they spend what they've got.
Yeah, I would say not all Republicans. The good news is we're starting to see Republican governors and Republican members of Congress also say the right things. I heard what Senator McConnell said a few weeks ago, and this has nothing whatsoever to do with our legacy issues. That's a complete myth. This isn't a blue state issue. This is about our ability to continue to employ versus laying them off. Can you imagine laying off firefighters, police, first responders, EMS, healthcare workers, educators, at the very moment we need these people more than we've ever needed them in the history of our country, to be left with no choice but to lay them off? That's the reality if we don't get federal direct cash assistance. And that's, again, not just blue states, it's all states.
Governor Phil Murphy of New Jersey. Governor, we wish you the best with all you're working on. Thank you.
Thanks for having me, Judy.
In the day's other news, the U.S. Supreme Court heard arguments on whether Electoral College members must back the presidential candidate who carries their states. The Electoral College determines the winner of the presidential election. President Trump won the electoral vote in 2016 while losing the popular vote. We'll take a closer look after the news summary. A federal judge has now delayed a decision on dismissing criminal charges against Michael Flynn, the former U.S. National Security Advisor. Instead, he's inviting legal experts and outside groups to weigh in. Flynn pled guilty to lying to the FBI during the Russia investigation, but the Justice Department now says the investigation was flawed from the start. Meanwhile, President Trump's one-time campaign chair, Paul Manafort, was released from federal prison. His lawyer says that it was due to fears about the coronavirus. Manafort will do the rest of his 7-year sentence for tax fraud, bank fraud, and conspiracy in home confinement. In Afghanistan, the death toll rose to 24 after an attack on a maternity hospital in Kabul. There was no claim of responsibility in Tuesday's assault, but the Taliban denied that it played any role. We'll take a closer look later in the program. U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo says that Israel needs to consider a number of issues before annexing West Bank settlements. Pompeo spoke after landing in Tel Aviv today. He's met separately with Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and with coalition partner Benny Gantz. Their political agreement calls for moving ahead with annexations. And back in this country, two states held special elections for the U.S. House races on Tuesday, and Republicans won both. In California, Mike Garcia captured what had been a Democratic seat near Los Angeles. And in Wisconsin, Republican Tom Tiffany easily won a seat in a pro-Trump district. Still to come on the NewsHour, the Supreme Court hears a critical argument that could affect future presidential elections. Nationwide stay-at-home orders raise concerns over a potentially dramatic increase in child abuse. The family of an American contractor held hostage by the Taliban speaks for the first time. And despite social distancing, musicians band together to create songs of comfort.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Since the coronavirus closed schools nationwide, children are staying at home. And coincidentally, during this 2-month period, reports to authorities of child abuse and neglect have declined dramatically. As William Brangham tells us, advocates for child welfare are especially concerned about what this says about their safety. Before we continue, a warning. This segment is focused on a sensitive subject, and if there are younger viewers with you, you may want to take a moment to pause or opt out.
That's right, Judy. In normal times, it is difficult to cover child welfare and allegations of child abuse. Now, with a pandemic, it is even more difficult. We wanted to begin by sharing some of the stories and concerns that we heard from many people who are working to try to prevent that abuse. Here's some of what we heard.
My name is Kelly White. I'm the co-CEO at the Safe Alliance in Austin, Texas. We work across the issues of child abuse, sex trafficking, sexual assault, domestic violence. We are particularly concerned because if children are at risk in a home, nobody is seeing them now.
Hi, I'm Georgia Booth, and I am in New York City with the Children's Aid Society. One of our biggest concerns during this pandemic is the safety and well-being of children. We rely heavily on schools and physicians and other adults that are coming in contact with children on a regular basis to report incidences of child abuse and neglect.
Hi, this is Jim Dudley. I am in Redwood City, California, and currently I'm a lecturer on faculty at San Francisco State University. When I was with the police department, I was the captain of our child abuse prevention and investigation group. In COVID-19 days, we don't get those reports, so it's up to the officers to be aware without those other sort of subtle hints that a child may be being abused.
I'm Leah Fraley. I'm the executive director of Stop Child Abuse Now of Northern Virginia. Reports are going down, which makes sense, right? There's less reports because the front line of child protection really isn't in that child's life anymore. Reports are going down. That doesn't mean abuse is going down, right? Just the reports. We are seeing minors making those reports, which is not typical.
I am Dr. Don Plumley. I am in Orlando, Florida, and I'm the medical director at Orlando Health Arnold Palmer Children's Hospital. What we've seen during the pandemic, unfortunately, is we've seen a major increase of children presenting with major injuries. There's children coming with broken bones, head injuries, burns, and we've probably seen an increase of at least 50% to 100% in these cases in the last 2 months.
I'm Xanthi Sharp. I live in Washington, D.C., and I'm the CEO and co-founder of The Fuller Project. The Fuller Project is a global nonprofit newsroom that's dedicated to reporting on the issues that most impact women. During coronavirus, there's been a spike of 230% in the material online, which is child sexual abuse, which is being shared. And that's material that is on the publicly accessible web.
We had a call from a child protective services worker because of a young woman that had been in our teen parent program that's a part of our children's shelter and had left to go back to, with her child, to go back to her family. And now her someone from her family that had been sexually aggressive toward her was now sexually abusing her child. We got them into our family shelter in a second.
There has been a breakdown as far as the actors that are monitoring and taking down this child sexually abusive material online. We have found through our reporting that the instances of material being taken down has been reduced by 89%.
In our two-county area, Orange County and Seminole County, Florida, we'll see 8 or 9 patients a month. In the last 2 months of March and April, we've seen 19 and 15 children that required hospitalizations.
For a family who, prior to the pandemic, was in that situation, stressed out, overwhelmed, worried about, et cetera, all of the things that really do lend to difficult environments, that's now worse, significantly worse.
So now to understand a bit more about those concerns, I'm joined now by Dr. Robert Seggi. He's a pediatrician at the Tufts Medical Center who works to combat these problems. He's also a senior fellow at Tufts Center for the Study of Social Policy. Dr. Seggi, thank you very much for being here. We heard some obviously very alarming reports of injuries going up, of sexual abuse online going up. What, in the midst of this pandemic, concerns you the most?
I think what I'm concerned about is we really don't know what's going on, that our state and most states around the country have seen a dramatic decline in child abuse reports. We know that some of the risk factors for child abuse are increased. Families are under more stress, more financial stress. Their children are home when they should be in school, and their parents are could be employed in essential businesses, they could be unemployed, or they could be trying to work from home. All of those things tend to increase family stress. And one thing we know about child abuse is most people who abuse their children are kind of at the end of the rope. There aren't that many people who are really bad. and wake up in the morning and say, I want to abuse or neglect my child. It's mostly good parents who just lose it.
So what we would expect in a pandemic like this, with people being cooped up for this amount of time, this in some ways is maybe inevitable is not the right word, but this is a not unexpected event.
No, you know, we saw in past natural disasters, there's been an increase in serious child abuse. During the Great Recession, there was an increase in the most serious kind of child abuse, the abusive head trauma for infants. So we're very worried. But, you know, this has never happened before. We're really concerned about what we don't see, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it's terrible for every child. And we're concerned that as we slowly begin to reemerge when it's safe to do so, these children have a place to go, people to talk to, and ways to talk about their experience, particularly if they've been abused or neglected in some way.
I'm just so struck by this idea that when there's a decline in reports of abuse, that sets off alarm bells for people like yourself.
Yeah, the thing about child abuse is most child abuse is not reported. And we know that in all times. And that's done because if you ask adults in many different ways, were you abused as a child, the numbers are much higher than the number of reports. So in all times, and now, the people who report child abuse are their teachers, their early childhood educators, sometimes their neighbors. The children may confide in someone like a grandparent or a beloved aunt or uncle, and those things end up becoming reports into the child welfare system. And of course, physicians, when we see children, if they have bruises that you can't explain or injuries, or they're or they appear to be neglected, we're also required by law to report. So all of those safety nets built around children just aren't there right now.
Do you have any advice for parents? I hear what you're saying, that this isn't a chronic condition for the most part. People aren't inherently abusive to their children. It's often a situational stress that sets it off. Let's say there are parents that are watching this who are feeling those feelings, are feeling stressed and anxious and nervous and frightened and angry. Is there any generalized advice you can offer for them?
Yeah, there are a couple of things that we know. The first one is reach out for help. Even though you can't physically join someone on telephone, video, any other way that you can get a chance to vent those feelings and know that it's not, you're not unusual. We're all feeling moments of frustration and despair under the circumstances. It's the way it is. Secondly, understand that your children's lives are disrupted also. So if they're misbehaving or they're having problems, take a moment to ask them what's going on and what they miss. Children don't know very much yet. They haven't been around long. And sometimes parents can help with some of the things that they're concerned about. And I think the other piece that I just sort of want to make sure to say is no one's very efficient or productive these days. Take some time, enjoy your children, build a fort, go for a walk, whatever it takes, just have some fun, because this is really bad, it's really hard, but maybe at the end of the day, we'll be able to look back and say, it was a really difficult time, but boy, did we laugh.
This is all very, very important advice to take to heart. Dr. Robert Segi at the Tufts Medical Center, thank you very, very much for your time.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Very important, as we heard, and as we just heard, there are a number of groups and hotlines you can call or find on the web if you know someone in need of help. We will include them on our site tonight. You can start with the Child Help National Child Abuse Hotline. It can be reached by phone or text at 1-800-4-A-CHILD, or you can go to childhelp.org/childhelp-hotline. President Trump reiterated today that the U.S. must leave Afghanistan, saying American troops are not a police force. But the horrors of that war were again brought into sharp focus with yesterday's cruel strike on a maternity hospital. And now, as the U.S. is withdrawing, the fate of one American held hostage lies in the balance. Here's Amna Nawaz.
A solemn prayer for the lives brutally taken in yesterday's attack on a maternity ward in Kabul. Crews today hastily worked to dig fresh graves for the victims, including expectant mothers and newborns.
I saw 8 dead bodies of women in this ward, and 7 other dead bodies were in the other ward, on the beds, and they were hitting their heads or faces.
As authorities were responding to yesterday's assault in Kabul, scores more were killed in the eastern province of Nangarhar. There, a suicide bomber attacked a funeral for the local police commander. The Taliban denied involvement in either of yesterday's attacks, but Afghan President Ashraf Ghani ordered his military to ramp up.
I order all the Afghan security and defense forces to come out of defensive mode back to offensive and start their operations against the enemy.
Yesterday's violence is just the latest crack in the already fracturing U.S. deal with the Taliban. In late February, the two parties entered into an agreement led by President Trump's appointed negotiator, Ambassador Zalmay Khalilzad. The U.S. would begin a troop withdrawal to end America's longest war, and in exchange, the Taliban would stop attacks on U.S. forces and deny other militant groups safe haven. The Afghan government was not part of that initial agreement, but the deal set the ground for further direct negotiations between Afghanistan and the Taliban. Those negotiations have been stalled in part by disagreements over prisoner exchanges and continued Taliban attacks on Afghan security forces. And the chaos and calamity raise questions about the fate of American Mark Freericks. The 57-year-old U.S. Navy veteran was working as a commercial contractor in Afghanistan when he was kidnapped at the end of January. U.S. officials believe he is held by the Haqqani Network, a faction of the Taliban. Earlier, I spoke with Freericks' family from their home in Lombard, Illinois. His sister, Charlene Sikora, is a retired gas company supervisor. Her husband, Chris, is a truck driver working overnight shifts. It's the family's first interview, exclusive to the NewsHour.
So a lot of people will hear his story, and they're going to wonder, what was he doing in Afghanistan?
He's been there over 10 years, and he was doing construction work. He just enjoyed it and stayed out there. And
found he could make very good money, tax-free money. And they let him do the kind of work that he liked to do that he really couldn't find here. So he enjoyed the environment and kept going back and eventually stayed. So we were kind of amazed at it, but it's something that he wanted to do. So we supported him.
Tell us how you came to know that he had been kidnapped.
We found out Sunday morning, Groundhog Day. We had a knock on our door at 9 o'clock in the morning, and it was Lombard police and the FBI came to our door and basically told us they wanted to talk to us. And they explained to us that my brother Mark has been kidnapped by the Taliban, the Haqqani group.
And what did you think in that moment?
I was shocked. I thought it was that I didn't believe it. I just basically couldn't say over again, are you sure? Are you sure? And they were very sure. I really didn't come into reality on it until then. They came to my house the following Tuesday, and I talked to Washington, D.C., and the whole big group, and then the reality set. And I just still can't believe it. And I cry every now and then at night, and I just think about what he's going through right now. Is he being bathed? Is he being fed? Is he clothed? I mean, is he warm? Does he have a pillow? I mean, I just can't imagine what he's going through right now.
Have you been able to get any kind of update on his well-being?
They're letting us know, the FBI, and when we talked to Zal, they basically are saying that he is alive. They're not saying that he's well, because they don't know. I mean, but they are saying that they don't have any reason to think that he's dead. But so they feel that he is still out there.
And when you say Zal, I should clarify, you mean Ambassador Zalmay Khalilzad, who's the chief U.S. negotiator dealing directly with the Taliban. But just last week, the FBI released a poster seeking information about the release of your brother. There was even a reported U.S. Special Forces raid looking for information on him and his whereabouts. Do you believe, Charlene, that the U.S. is doing everything that they can to get Mark released?
Sometimes I think yes, and sometimes I think no. I know this COVID thing has taken over, and I feel that the FBI and the U.S. government's doing what they can do, but I really don't feel comfortable that Zal is doing anything, and he's the one that's got the power to do all, you know, to get Mark home safely.
It sounds like Zal is still more worried about doing a prisoner exchange of great numbers rather than looking at the importance of one person, and that's Mark, and getting Mark home.
Let me ask you about what it is you'd like to see, because now you have the U.S. chief negotiator who's dealing with the Taliban saying, I have asked them to do everything they can. Clearly, he's working under the direction of President Trump. So what else specifically do you want to see the U.S. government do to make sure that Mark is released?
That no negotiations go on about trading prisoners or anything in that regards until Mark is brought home. Then, you know, whatever they need to do, they need to do, but they need to put Mark first.
You'd like to see the entire negotiation process stop until there's a precondition that Mark is released. Is that right?
I believe that would be right, yeah.
And if the process moves forward without that precondition, what are you worried would happen?
That he'd be forgotten. That, you know, we all need to understand, too, that Zal's professional and an ambassador, and that's what he's going to do with or without certain accomplishments. But our concern is only for Mark.
Let me make this clear, though, because we are talking about America's longest war, right? Three presidents have tried to end this now, and President Trump believes that we could be closer than ever to having some kind of a deal and getting U.S. troops home. Are you worried that the commitment to that goal could mean that Mark gets left behind?
Very much so.
Yes.
Very much so.
Fear, I think of every day that I'm going to wake up some morning and this is all going to be signed and clear and Mark's not home safely. And the peace deal has been signed and done, a done deal, and Mark still is out there. And what are we going to do then?
We've seen President Trump get very directly involved to try to negotiate prisoners' release in the past from different countries. Do you think it would help Mark's case if he were to do the same in this situation?
I think it would do more help than harm at this point. And he's shown he's a pretty powerful guy. He's gone up toe-to-toe against the strongest leaders in the world and come out okay.
Yeah, I really support the President Trump, that he will bring my brother home safely. He's done it in the past with other prisoners. So I believe he'll get my brother home.
If you could deliver a message right now to President Trump, what would you say to him?
I would say, please bring my brother Mark home safely. And please don't do any more signing, any more deals until my brother's included in that deal and getting my brother home safe.
Charlene, let me ask you, because this is the very first interview anyone in your family has given, why are you talking to us today?
It's been long enough that I feel that we have to be a little stronger and move more forward and more aggressive. I have to get more out there, more to get the word out and maybe get President Trump a little bit more mentioning my brother Mark's name,
more motivated,
and more motivated. And I think the more my brother Mark's name is put out there, I think the more, you know, the power up there will do what they got to do, because we are very concerned.
If you had a way of getting a message straight to Mark, what would you want to say to him right now?
I just want to tell him that we're doing everything we can to get you home. I miss you. And I just want you home safely. And I've worried about you over a decade with this. Mm-hmm. And we felt so comfortable that you were doing okay and you were safe out there. I guess we just let our guard down. But I want you home safe. And I'm doing everything I can to get you home safe. So just hang in there. He's my brother. I love him. My only brother. And we're only 2 years apart, so we were always close as kids and hung out. And he was always my bodyguard in high school when I got picked on. And he's always been there for me. So I got to be here for him.
Charlene and Chris Sikora talking to us today from Lombard, Illinois. Thank you so much for your time. We wish you and your family all the very best.
Thank you for your time.
Can states punish presidential electors for bucking a pledge to vote for the winner in their state? That was the question at the heart of today's Supreme Court arguments. John Yang has the story.
I'm just a guy. I was just a regular person. I wasn't a politician.
He may be a regular guy, but Michael Baca was one of just 538 people chosen to vote for president in 2016. That's right. While more than 150 million Americans headed to the polls on November 8, 2016 to choose between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, the presidency was actually decided weeks later by the 538 members of the Electoral College.
When people cast their vote, they are actually voting for a group of people called electors.
This indirect election of the president is established by the Constitution. Each state has the same number of electoral votes as their representation in the House and the Senate. Candidates need 270 votes to win, and most states are winner-take-all. In 2016, Clinton won the popular vote in Colorado, so all nine of the state's electoral votes were supposed to go to her. But Baca, one of Colorado's electors, voted for Republican John Kasich. It was part of a plan he hatched with other electors to try to prevent Mr. Trump from becoming president.
It was to find a moderate Republican. The popular vote winner of Colorado was Hillary Clinton, but the majority of people in Colorado did not want Donald Trump.
Jason Harrow is Baca's attorney.
They were putting country over party, and there is a place for that. It's not to blow up the system. It's actually to further our constitutional democracy.
Colorado invalidated Baca's vote and replaced him with an alternate who did vote for Clinton.
Electors are supposed to go and vote. And when I attempted to go and exercise my right to vote in the Electoral College in 2016, I was denied that vote.
Colin Powell from the Commonwealth of Virginia has received 3 votes.
As then-Vice President Joe Biden announced the results, 7 so-called faithless electors were successful in casting their ballots for other candidates. In Washington state, 4 of them were fined $1,000 each. They and Baca sued. Today, meeting once again by phone, the Supreme Court heard a pair of arguments on the constitutionality of state laws punishing faithless electors. Marcia Coyle is chief Washington correspondent for the National Law Journal.
The court has ruled way back in 1952 that states can require electors to pledge to support certain candidates or political parties' candidates. But the court has never said whether the states can enforce pledges. It is an unprecedented question for them.
But just months before the next presidential election, the stakes for the justices were clear. Justice Samuel Alito pressed Lawrence Lessig, the attorney for the Washington state electors.
Those who disagree with your argument say that it would lead to chaos. Do you deny that that is a good possibility if your argument prevails?
We deny it's a good possibility. We don't deny it's a possibility, and we believe there are risks on either side. In the history of electors, there has been one elector out of the 23,507 votes cast who has switched parties against the majority party in a way that it could have mattered.
Rick Hassan, an election law expert at UC Irvine Law School and author of Election Meltdown, explained the potential risk.
These electors could be subject to pressure. They could be subject to bribes. They could vote in an independent way, and that would throw off the results. Imagine the election is very close, and it just takes one or two electors changing their views.
During today's arguments, Washington Solicitor General Noah Purcell defended his state's decision to fine faithless electors as a way to protect 3 million other voters.
Once the legislature has given the power to vote to the public now has a fundamental right to vote and to have their votes counted equally. And as this court has said in a number of cases, and so the legislature can't then override that vote after the fact. It would radically change how American presidential elections have always worked in our country.
But Chief Justice John Roberts pressed Baca's attorney on what limits may be placed on an elector.
so the elector can decide, I am going to vote, I'm going to flip a coin, and however it comes out, that's how I'm going to vote.
Yes, Your Honor. That's the same discretion that U.S. senators have, representatives have, congressional electors have. These two are elected officials, and they have that same discretion.
Well, that sounds pretty limitless to me.
Depending on how the justices rule, the Republicans and Democrats may do things differently this fall.
This is not an exaggeration. I expect there are going to be investigators investigating the lives of these electors to make sure that these are people who are those who would reliably vote for Joe Biden or Donald Trump.
Presidential candidates and electors should have a better idea of their options before the party nominating conventions later this summer. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang.
Finally tonight, our occasional look at the Songs of Comfort project that world-renowned cellist Yo-Yo Ma launched on social media. Jeffrey Brown looks at the growing collaboration in these mini performances as tough times bring people together through music and technology. It's part of our ongoing arts and culture series, Canvas.
In a time of isolation, a desire to connect through music. As the psychology of pandemic changes through the weeks, you can see that play out in the hashtag Songs of Comfort project through more and more collaborations. That includes the man who started it all, Yo-Yo Ma, who recorded a distance duet with celebrated West African singer Angelique Kidjo, and another with Syrian-born clarinetist Kinan Azmi. The urge to merge is often a family affair, as with this young mother and father in their Berlin, Germany living room. Their new baby adding a little percussion. In Arizona, six women family members put the 70s song I'd Like to Teach the World to Sing to multi-stringed accompaniment.
I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Joined by the whistling of the person capturing it all on camera. Violinist with the Washington, D.C. area National Philharmonic sat down with her guitar-playing son for a piece by Astor Piazzolla. There are also more elaborate cross-genre collaborations, a delightful Bach to the Bar breakfast scene, created by musicians from the Toronto Symphony and dancers with the Canadian National Ballet, plus two children who performed their roles to perfection. Much older children at Potomac, Maryland, St. Andrew's Episcopal School sang Oh Happy Day, joined by alumni and faculty. And 24 student cellists from around the world managed to get together for a performance of Saint-Saëns' The Swan. Houston, members of the symphony, used to playing together on stage, created a virtual quartet. And while it can be a lonely time for many, technology allows another kind of quartet, all the parts performed by one individual. Songs played alone. Songs played together. And as we saw in that Berlin living room, some things don't change. The desire to share and maybe inspire the next generation. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown.
Songs of Comfort, that has to continue after this pandemic. And tune in later tonight on PBS to watch the premiere of Nova's Decoding COVID-19. The one-hour film follows scientists in the global race to develop a vaccine and takes viewers to the front lines in Wuhan, China, and New York during the height of the outbreak. That's Decoding COVID tonight on PBS at 9 Eastern, 8 Central. You can stream it as well across PBS's digital platforms. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening for all of us at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you. Please stay safe and see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Consumer Cellular offers no-contract wireless plans that are designed to help you do more of the things you enjoy. Whether you're a talker, texter, browser, photographer, or a bit of everything, our U.S.-based customer service team is here to find a plan that fits you. To learn more, go to consumercellular.tv.
Life isn't a straight line, and sometimes you can find yourself heading in a new direction. Fidelity is here to help you work through the unexpected with financial planning and advice for today and tomorrow.
BNSF Railway. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.